All right, everybody. Welcome to Atlanta Startup Village number 73. Give yourselves a round of applause. It is the end of the year. It's a little cold. It's a weird Monday. I know you're used to the last Monday, but it's not as fun when it's like right after Thanksgiving. So I am Allie. I am your MC, which means that I sometimes say pretty things about our presenters. Sometimes I tell the people in the back to be a little quieter. Just in case you're wondering, this is, I would like to say it's an intimate space, but it's sort of cavernous. But that really just means that your sound carries. So if you're in the back having this like super secret conversation, it's not so secret. We can hear you. Please take it out into the foyer or past the double doors because we are all here to see the presenters tonight. So please give them the respect that they deserve because that's what they're here for. All right, so we have a couple of housekeeping pieces. Forgive me for having the paper to do this. So first of all, we have a fantastic sponsor. I'm gonna say this, even though it's not like a beer sponsor, but it's a perpetual sponsor. So we're on number 73. Since I think number 2, Atlanta Tech Village has been the sponsor for us. They have been the sponsor for the space. They've been the sponsor for the beer. They've been the sponsor for organizing all these chairs that you sit in. So please give a warm round of applause for Kellyanne from AATV.
Hello, hello, everyone. We are so glad you are here tonight for the 73rd Startup Village. As she said, I'm Kellyanne. I am the director of programming here at the Village. How many of you are here for the first time? Awesome. That's great. Well, welcome. You are currently in the fourth largest tech startup hub in the nation, which means it's a great place to be. We have over 1,100 members that make up over 300 startups in this building. So if these walls could speak, they would tell you of great success, and we love being a part of it. So if you are an entrepreneur and you have a tech startup with proprietary technology, we would love for you to call the Village home. So if that is you, you can email our community manager to get set up with a tour. Her name is Julie, and it's simply julie@atlantatechvillage.com. Otherwise, enjoy the show.
All right, so the other thing that happens with our fantastic sponsors is that this gentleman back here with the camera is Paul Spark. Can everybody turn around and give him a little wave, please? It makes for really good TV later. Thank you. So Paul Spark every single month videos this, they live stream it, they record it, they get to play it back, so our presenters get to play it back later. I play it back every month. It's not super fun, but that's how you get better. So you can actually see yourself if you ask a super smart question or if you ask a really long question. So think about that before you ask your questions. It will live forever on the interweb. So Paul Spark does this out of the kindness of their hearts, but they also provide full video options. So if you need somebody here in town to do video for you, they are the ones to talk to, so please go see them directly after. Okay, so you're all sitting in chairs, you all got name tags, there are nice people pouring you beer. The way that this works is we have 30-second volunteers, which means you show up, you get 30 seconds to come up here and present in front of all you fantastic people, and all you have to do in return is pour some beer and put out some name tags. Pretty good, right? So we are gonna let all of our volunteers present. If after this you would like to be a volunteer at a later point, please come up and see me after the show and we can talk through when that will be. We typically take about 5 volunteers and those slots get filled up fast, so think through this. All right, so my volunteers for tonight. First up, I've got Bray and Carlos. Come on down. Round of applause, yes.
Hey guys, how are you guys doing? My name is Brian Torres and I'm with Brechner Media. What we do is we are a product design and development company. So what we specialize in is we're able to take entrepreneurs from that first idea, that first step that they have, and maybe they don't have the resources or maybe they don't have the technical know-how to act on their idea, or maybe they have the business side, maybe they have the amazing business model, the marketing, but they don't have the tech side and they need help with the product and tech side. So what we do is we're able to take entrepreneurs to that, to a revenue generating MVP in 13 weeks, and that's what we try to specialize in. Again, my name is Bri Torres, and this is Brechner Media.
Your information, it will be on the back wall in the back, and they will be back there after the show if you want to talk to them. So my next presenter, Russell, where are you? Come on down, Russell. Give him a round of applause.
Hey, our website is in green on the white wall. It's just southernentrepreneur.org. We're having a conference in Noonan, Georgia. If you know anything about Georgia, nothing entrepreneurial is happening south of the airport. So we're doing Southern Entrepreneur Conference in Noonan next May. And We're going to have two keynotes and three breakout session leaders. Everybody has to have built their company from the ground up and been successful in order to speak. One of our speakers has led an angel investment firm, and she's going to be teaching listeners how to pitch her idea to angel investors. And then we're going to have an after party at a restaurant. That's this really big patio like you used to party at in college, but we're just all going to come together after the conference and have a good time. I'm going to be here, and I've got some handouts if you want one.
So for any of you guys who haven't been here yet, I encourage clapping. Please clap, or I keep asking you to. There you go. All right. So my third volunteer, are you ready? Andrew. Where are you, Andrew? Give him a round of applause.
My name is Andrew Beaver, and as a private football coach... Thank you. So, as a private football coach, I sometimes find it difficult to find quality training material for my clients. So what I decided to do is create a centralized platform where trainers across the country can provide their material and generate some passive income to athletes, parents, and coaches. So currently, if you want to get on website, thedrillfactory.com, you can find 400 individual drills I created myself for football, speed, agility, and explosiveness. All I really ask of you today is to share with any athletes or parents or trainers who want to generate some passive income. Thank you.
And my fourth volunteer of the night, I'm going to give her a second to get up. Kimberly, come on down.
Hi, my name is Kimberly Qualls. I am the founder of Happier Startup Consulting. I've been in the startup world for about 10 years now and at the C-level for about 5. And if there's anything I've learned, it's that if you're not having fun, you're not doing it right. So I am here with some friends of mine to provide our business acumen to people who are looking for help with their startups so that it can be more fun. We do both short-term projects and long-term advisory services in marketing, finance, operations, and more. So if you're getting to some trouble and want someone to come on and help you out, come and find me. Thank you.
That's all there is to it. Super easy. You get the entire company here, as well as we actually have typically 50 to 100 people who are watching us on this lovely live stream. So there are a lot of people in the audience, so keep that in mind if you want to present or if you want to be a volunteer. Are we ready to go? Okay. So who is here for some startups? Yes. I was going to say, I expect enthusiasm. Don't worry, there will be swag later. I run around in the crowd. I try not to throw things. Nobody wants me to do that. But I will have some swag later. In the meantime, I would like you to give a... We're going to let her pull that all the way to the back. Are you a pacer? You're going to pace, Caitlin. All right, Caitlin's a pacer. Okay. We would like to give a warm round of applause for Caitlin with New Crew.
Hey, everyone. My name is Caitlin Lutz, and I'm the founder of New Crew, Qualified Construction Workers on Demand. And I'm going to grab my clicker so I can actually change my slides. And these are my parents. They own a construction company, and they need to hire an electrician. But hiring sucks. They ask around, and they interview for months, but they can only find workers who show up for a week or steal their equipment. They don't know how to find qualified labor. And this is Jen. She's a quality electrician and a mom. She loves her job, she loves being an electrician, but she hates that she has to drive 2 hours every single day to her job site. She wants to work closer to her home and to her family, but she doesn't know her options. There are over 700,000 open jobs in the construction industry. Most workers find jobs through the buddy system. I know a guy who knows a guy, and that's how I get my job. Skilled labor is a $400 billion market. Most US construction companies struggle to find labor when they need it. And I have personally interviewed over 300, yes, 300 construction companies who have this very problem. And all of these issues cause turnover. And turnover in the construction industry, is causing these companies to lose over $30 billion every single year. The solution is New Crew, connecting commercial construction companies with vetted, skilled labor. Remember Jen, this is how she gets a job. She applies in under 60 seconds, she is screened over the phone, She is assessed through an online skills exam, and she is vetted through a background check. Because we want to ensure the quality of our workers, we only take a small percentage of applicants into our active network. Now, if Jen isn't going through her word of mouth network, she's probably applying to jobs and finding jobs through job postings and job boards like ZipRecruiter or Indeed. But the problem with these job boards is oftentimes they require that you fill out a resume or that you have a resume. And most skilled workers don't have resumes. And so through texting automation, Jen can fill out her resume. Staffing agencies provide low-quality labor who often don't show. Recruiters are expensive and slow, but at least you have Craigslist, right? New Crew is quality labor fast. In the last quarter, we've added over 200 electricians to our network. We have 6 customers, and we have over $20,000 in committed revenue. We're starting with electrical contractors. Our target customer are commercial electrical contractors in Georgia. And to find customers and the electricians, we're partnering with trade schools, construction associations, general contractors, and electrical supply shops. We charge a 45% markup for contract positions and 15% to hire the worker out. Electrical is not the only trade that suffers from this problem. HVAC, welding, mechanical, carpentry, the list could go on and on and on. The dream is for New Crew to be a fully automated platform that serves millions of gens and thousands of businesses like my parents. My ask is for any contacts that you have within the commercial construction industry, and specifically if you know any commercial electrical contractors. And my name is Caitlin Lutz, my company is New Crew, and I would love to answer any of your questions or talk to you at the end. Thank you so much. And I have actually one last pitch. My little sister is in the audience. Her name is Evie, and she has an ask as well.
Hello, my name is Evie Lutz. I'm a senior in high school, and I'm looking for internships. So if you're a software company or you're interested, I would love to chit-chat. Have a great day.
She is super bright. Any questions? The question is, am I nationwide? And the answer is no, definitely not. I'm only focusing on Georgia at the moment. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I love Johnny On It. If you guys haven't downloaded Johnny On It's, oh yes, oh, I'm sorry. So the question is, what's the difference between me and a startup here in Atlanta Tech Village called Johnny On It? Download the Johnny On It app, they're great. So Johnny On It specifically works in the residential construction industry. And what they're doing is they're connecting service companies, so construction companies that already exist, to jobs. And I'm connecting individual workers with construction companies. Yes? Yeah, that's a great question. So the question is, do the workers that are in my network have to be professional engineers, or can they just be technicians? So I'm specifically working with commercial electrical contractors. I'm mostly working with people who have at least 10 years experience and who are certified journeymen. I'm not afraid of your questions. I'm ready. Yeah. Great question. I can just go back to this slide really fast. So at the moment, great question. The question is, how do I make money? So I'll add in this staffing component within a month and a half, and so I'll charge a 45% markup for contract positions, and then if they want to buy the worker out after 90 days, then they can pay the 15% fee. And right now I'm recruiting 4 positions, so it's like all this is tech-enabled, but I'm recruiting 4 positions, and I charge a 15% fee for their first year salary. The question is, what is my main source of inspiration for creating this company? And so my parents are obviously in the construction industry. And I was on the phone with my mom one day, and she said that they had a plumber who showed up to work drunk. And it caused a bunch of issues in their business. And they would, and then she went on and on about, you know, all their labor that wouldn't show up at all, and they had a huge turnover problem. There's a 61% turnover rate in construction, and it caused huge issues in their business, and I was really feeling for her, and I looked more into the issue, saw all these open jobs, saw that over 90% of construction companies suffer from this problem, and actually, I also saw that women make up 4% of skilled workers in construction. And so I actually started a nonprofit called Spark Women that works to equip more women for skilled trade positions. And in starting that nonprofit, I interviewed 300 construction companies and started interviewing all the skilled workers, and then saw that they were really inefficiently matching up with jobs, and that's when I created New Crew. Yes. So the question is, who does the screening and vetting, and do I have high overhead because of that? So right now, I'm doing my screening and vetting, and once I start staffing for these positions, so they'll do their all their work through me, then I will be allowed to do the background check and the drug test. And right now, I make sure to get all their references and call up all their references and that sort of thing. And so right now, they'll definitely all have to have references going forward, and that can be scalable, but I'm doing all the vetting myself at the moment. And my overhead is not too high because of that, and it costs about $10 per background check. Yes?
So you have a lot of positions that you're contracting and hiring for, rating system. For each worker that does a good job, will you or do you already have incorporated a system where it's a feedback-based system for jobs that they do and build up a little portfolio resume?
Absolutely, yeah. So the question is, do I have a rating system, or is that something that I'm planning on creating so that the workers can have a portfolio? And the answer is definitely yes. That's not something that is a huge focus right now. Focused on making money, hopefully. But definitely in the future. Yes.
You mentioned it briefly, but employing that equipment is a big deal.
Yeah.
If you're in retail and somebody steals a little toy from you to take it, it's one thing, but they still thousands of dollars and stuff. So how do you call former employers to find out? I mean, how do you find out if they might steal it?
Yeah, absolutely. So that's definitely a big issue, not just with my parents. Yes, I'm sorry. So the question is, how will you deal with employee theft? And do you call on, you know, their past employers, and how do you make sure that they aren't going to steal anything or cause issues? And that is a huge issue in the construction industry. So everybody has to have at least two references, and all of them are called. And often you can tell if a worker is, you know, if they have 10 jobs within, you know, a certain period of time, and there's issues with their, and they can't provide references. So I have 200 electricians who have applied to my network, and I've only accepted 30 of them. And so we really are trying to ensure the quality of workers.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
All right, so this is where I do a song and dance over here while we swap out presenters, which means that I have a pair of socks for a giveaway. So, we've done a couple of different things in the past. Sometimes people get things under their seats. Sometimes ask for dance contests. How enthusiastic are people about getting a pair of socks? Dear Lord. Oh, no. He's winning in the back. Are you louder? Are you louder? Oh. This is... Oh, see, he got up too, but he got up first, man. All right. He was first, but there will be more. There will be more, don't worry. I have two more pairs of socks, it will happen. He looks so sad right now. Do I need to do a dance-off if that's what's happening? Audience, how do you feel about a dance-off? All right, get up, let's hit. No, what? Oh, he called it. He didn't even want to do the dance-off. I'm a little sad right now, I'm not gonna lie. I even got really good music. I mean, it's a little more dancey than I really wanted, but okay. We can work with that. All right. Man, you win some socks, props. I know. We're going to talk about this afterwards. All right, so next time we're gonna do a dance off because everybody's gonna be enthusiastic. The audience was into it, I don't know. All right, I have more swag. Usually people aren't that enthusiastic, but I like it. We can keep doing that. Can we please get a warm welcome for our second presenter of the night, Maya Alomari. I have to do that because you guys don't clap.
Hello, everyone. My name is Priya Thinagar, and I am the founder of My Alomari. Alomari means closet or wardrobe. It sounds like calamari without the C, if you have to remember it. We are an online luxury marketplace that focuses on renting designer clothing and handbags to support the consumer, you know, responsible consumerism. I want to tell a couple of stories. Does this thing work?
All right, we're gonna give her a second. So anybody who has not yet presented, I know some former presenters in the house. I got several. I may have given away a pair of socks. I could see several. If you have not presented before, this is the place to be. Please come see me after. 5-minute presentation. You just have to be based in Atlanta. And we will backfill when you need time. Are you ready?
Yeah,
are
I
we
am.
Good?
Yeah.
Can we give her another round of applause? Yeah.
So I want to tell you about a story of my friend Namita. She was invited to this prestigious event at the embassy in Washington, D.C. as a keynote speaker. She wanted to talk about her ethnic background, her hometown, the craftsmanship of indigenous workers in her hometown, and she wanted to wear an ethnic designer clothing to the event. Would we all not want to? She has two choices there. She can either look and rummage through her closet, look at what she has in her closet, find something that she can wear, but she doesn't like what she sees in her closet. So she has to go spend the dollars to go to an expensive boutique and find something that would fit her needs. So she is stressed, she's worried, she's not sure she's going to find what she's going to look for, and she thinks she is going to settle for less, and she's a little concerned about it. On the other hand, I have a cousin, Amy, that bought this expensive Gucci bag that is sitting in her closet. She used it 2 times, and it's been collecting a lot of dust. Every time she wants to go buy a new handbag, she is guilted, not just by her, but her entire family. Oh, you have that Gucci bag sitting there. Do you want another one? And so she's kind of stressed about, what do I do? I want to buy a new handbag, but I can't. We come to the rescue of these two and countless other women that are looking to have their Maharani moment. We provide a technology platform where Amy can lend her Gucci bag to us at My Alomari. We take great care of her prized possession, and we rent it out, and she makes the money, and she can go buy other handbags if she wants to. On the other hand, Namita can browse through our endless collection of underutilized designer clothes that we have on our website, choose what she wants, wear the style, and easily return it for an easy goodbye with our prepaid labels. We give these women what they want. They are supporting the circular economy, they are supporting responsible consumerism, and we love that they do that. So I'm going to show you a demo of how easy it is to rent on our website right now. So, like Ali said, I logged in to the website beforehand, but I can't find my mouse to work. I think I know why. Because I found it. So I'm going to click on the rent button, and I'm going to pick this outfit. I really like this outfit. I am just going to, it's not showing up on the site, so let Let me just go back. No, I can't. Oh, there we go. But I can't find my PowerPoint anymore. Oh. Oh, there. I think I'll end my slideshow. Sorry about that. So, you know, I am on the website. All I clicked on was the rent button, and I picked, you know, one of the outfits. I like the size. You know, I am sort of a size 8-ish. And I'm going to pick a date. So we allow 4-day rentals. So, you know, I pick the date, and I say add to bag. I've added it to the bag. It shows up. If I have a promo code, I can apply the promo code. In the previous screen, if I wanted to zoom in, I could do that as well. I can hit on the next. It already pre-populates my address. I've already saved it in my address book for convenience. And I've also saved my credit card number. I didn't want to, you know, put it in front of all of you guys. I'm going to place the order. And there goes it. You know, I get a nice confirmation page. And, you know, I also get an email that the order has been placed and it'll be shipped to me. So our ask at this point, you know, again, this is an on-demand rental. At this point, our ask is to get some marketing professional to help us share the message of hope. It is the season of the holiday season of hope. So the hope, the message of hope that we want to provide is for fashion freedom, for the circular economy and responsible consumerization, and also to support the various indigenous women that are crafting a lot of these outfits and supporting slow fashion all around the world. Thank you so much. Sure, go ahead.
So for the person that's selling the clothes to be added to the inventory, are they getting guidelines for what's acceptable quality?
So the question was, you know, for the person that is, lending their clothes to us, are there guidelines that are provided for them? We do have that, you know, on our site. You know, we have a lend or sell page where we say, you know, what does it take to lend an item with us? There is also a wiki link that says, how do you take pictures of your outfits? So they usually will fill out a form, send at least one image of the item to us. We take a look at it. We verify the authenticity of the designer. Because we are doing luxury design clothing, so we look at the authenticity of it, and then once we're ready, we take professional, you know, photo shoots of those clothes and then put it on our website. So we maintain the whole life cycle of the clothes once it comes to us. Go ahead. So the question was, what do you do if an item that a customer lends to us is damaged? So we do have a TNC that says that it is potential that when your items go out for rentals that it could get slight wear and tear. If it's a slight wear and tear, then we take care of the maintenance of it. Whether it's a stitch, a button, that's lost, or a zipper that goes and things like that. But if it is heavy damage, we charge the customer, the person that's renting from us, the amount that's required to pay back to the customer that lent that item. Go ahead.
Yeah, are y'all operating mostly online? Do y'all have plans or already operating with overhead, just a site of
So the question was, do we have just the website or do we have a store or someplace for customers to try? We currently operate completely online. It's an e-commerce, website, and it's also, available on the mobile apps. But our desire is to actually invest in augmented reality So that's the next thing that we're looking at to see if a customer can sit at the comfort of their home and try some of these things before they rent these clothes from us. Maybe we should talk. I saw a lot of excitement there.
That's a cool idea, yes.
Thanks. Yeah, the question was, with a lot of luxury design and, you know, fashion, you know, photography plays a big part, you know, especially that, you know, we don't have a store or anything, you know, what do we do about it for in-house photography? So the last few rounds, we've had, local talent out of SCAD, helping us with some of the photography and the editing and all that stuff. We've also had some done in India, you know, some of the ethnic clothes, you know, came from some designers and, folks in India. So, you know, we were able to do some, design shots, but we're always constantly looking for people to help us with, pictures and photos. Hey, go ahead. So the question was, you know, how do you authenticate your handbags? You know, how do I know that I'm getting a real Birkin bag and not a fraudulent item? You know, we're very strict on our site, fraud. So if we do notice that there is a fraudulent, you know, handbag or designer wear, we immediately, you know, shut off that customer or the lender so they can't, you know, sell through our site or lend through our site. But today we have in-house authenticators that know the, so this is just, you know, people that we have that actually authenticate some of these items that we have today. We're also working on a seal of authenticity that we put on every single one of our bags, and it's a tamper-proof, seal that we put in, so, you know, folks can return, when they return back to us, we see that seal, of authenticity is still there. As well. So we'll probably try to invest in some technology solutions in the future, but right now, you know, that's the manual thing that we're doing.
Excellent.
Thank you so much.
Y'all, it's a hard job to present in front of you guys, so thank you for being supportive. So in the grand scheme of me giving things away, I have a hat. It's Atlanta Tech Village hat. I'm not going to make you do a dance off. Like, I feel like we already got that out of the way, even though there wasn't dancing off. It's fine. Hats? Anybody? Anybody interested? Oh, all right. He got real excited. He got real excited. There we go. First, man. There's more to come. Don't worry. The dance-off will happen. Dad, you say that, but I haven't seen you do the dance-off yet. Okay. I still have a pair of socks and two shirts under there. Don't worry. There will be more. Grab a beer super quietly if you're grabbing a beer. Thank you all. Okay, we are on to our third presenter of the night. We ready to go? Good? Okay. Can we give a warm welcome, please, to Jump In? This is where you clap.
Hey, everyone. My name is Justin Matthews, and I'm here to talk about Jump In, the exercise board game app. So, I love HIIT workouts. HIIT being high intensity interval training, you get a great workout in a short amount of time. You have typically some weights, maybe some body weight exercises. And there's a million gyms in Atlanta that provide these services, right? You have your Orange Theory, your F45, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And when I'm in traffic and I can't make it to those gyms, I have similar apps that provide a workout like that at home. So, I have all these apps and I've been, you know, doing these different workouts, but I've always kind of questioned the effectiveness of those workouts because I'd never done a minute of squats. I'm like, well, how many did I actually do in that whole minute? What did I actually accomplish at the end of that? And so that's where the light bulb really came on for Jump In, that there wasn't like a great app that sort of connected those two where you weren't tracking all of your reps that you did and you weren't getting low enough or like, you know, doing all the exercises correctly. So what Jump In is, it's a fitness tracker app that counts all of your reps and all of the exercises that we have you do. So that's one of our biggest features. We make sure that your form is tight and that you're getting low enough in all of your reps. So your push-ups are actually, you know, getting close enough to the ground. Your squats are getting low enough as well. You don't need any equipment whatsoever, no weights, no watches, no nothing. All you need is yourself and your phone. And what we're trying to do is gamify exercise. We're trying to make it really fun and interactive, where you're, you know, playing against a computer right now, but eventually you'll be able to play against your friends. So now I'm going to give you guys a demo of it, of the workout. So this is the home screen when you first log in. We have all of your workouts saved, and along with your averages and your best workouts. Said right there, you can also connect with us, so please do. And let's go into the game. So I will start the game. I'm playing against the evil computer right now. I'll simulate, not dips this time, I'll just do push-ups just to show you it work. And there's one, and there's two. And I could have kept going, but I'll stop for you guys. So you can also, you know, scale the workout up and down depending on what it is. You can pause the game. You can also have it ding for you so you know you're, you know, getting low enough if you, like, close your eyes during workouts or something. And you can share your workout and your results once you get done. And so it's a 10-minute workout. There's 6 different exercises that we track right now today, but we, you know, can always add more as we, like, build the app out. Back to this. And so to date, we've had almost 3,000 downloads, so that's really positive, and great to see, but I'm always looking for more, so please download the app when you have an opportunity. But just to give you guys the history of it, it's been like a labor of love with this. It initially started out as a physical product, and that's me at a middle school. I'm in Mississippi, like, trying it out, and it was just, you know, not as scalable as an app was. So then we pivoted and created an app, and that allowed us to, like, you know, reach more people, obviously. But that's why we think we're well equipped to, like, to be in this space and to continue to work in this. So I talked a little bit about the past and what we're currently doing, and now we're just talking about what we're looking towards. And, you know, right now you can compete against the evil computer. I'm trying to beat them in the 10-minute workout. But eventually, you'll be able to compete against your friends. So that's what we're really excited about. In addition to that, it's new exercises, heart rate tracking, and power-ups. So, you know, what's important is, like, how are you going to make money off this? So it's potentially with the new exercises, just having different packages with that, and also with power-ups. If you think about, like, Trivia Crack or Words with Friends, we're trying to do the same thing except for fitness. So that's the presentation. So what I need from you guys now is to download the app, try it, and then just let me know what you think on Twitter or on the website. And yeah, definitely tell your friends too. So there's 4 things I need you guys to do. And that's it. Any questions? The question was, is it available on iOS and Android? It is only available on iOS today.
Is it a paid app?
Oh, sorry. I got you. No, you're good. You're good. I got you. So she said, is it a paid app? And it is free. It is $3.99 today. Yeah.
I deal.
Yeah, exactly.
Is there, like, a long-term monetization strategy?
She asked, is there a long-term monetization strategy with it? So what I'm hoping to do first is just eventually put ads on there, and then the specific long-term monetization strategy is related to the new exercises that we'll add to the app. So just if you've been on, like, a lot of those fitness apps, they have different exercise packages, like your booty workout, your ab workout, your upper body. So we have those specific exercises, and then as well power-ups. If you think Trivia Crack or Words with Friends, like different defensive power-ups you can do against the other players you would play against, so, you know, to win the game, because the point of the game is to have more reps than the other player at the end. Right here. Yeah, this is a good question. So she asked, what heart rate tracker or sensor do you plan on adding to your app to have that feature added. And actually, you don't need any. Your phone can do the same heart rate tracking through the camera. There's apps now that you just put your finger on the camera of it, the camera phone, and it'll track your heart rate from there. So that we plan on using that because we don't want to like have you buy anything outside of your phone. We want to keep it all in-house like that. So his question was, are there any apps out there today that allow you to train or, gauge yourself against professional athletes? And I can't say that I know of any off the top of my head. And I've been, looking at a ton of apps, just, trying to do some, user research and just figure out what the market has. But I can't say I know of any off the top of my head.
Check out MySwim Pro.
Say that one more time?
MySwim Pro.
Gotcha. Okay. So his question was, who is my target market? Who do I see using this app? And I really see my target market as people that don't have typical gym memberships and have a hard time getting to the gym. So maybe parents of young kids, and they don't have that time because you get a quick, efficient workout in a short amount of time. And that's who I see really using this app. That's a good question. So how will I educate the users of the app to make sure that they are, using the proper form and keeping themselves safe while they're doing it? So right now we just have, you saw in the app, there's just images right now that kind of show the form and how you're supposed to be doing it over the phone. In addition to that, we do have just some readable text in there if you were to swipe over so you can read a description about how you're supposed to do the workout. Eventually, you notice a lot of the apps, they do little short gifts of the person doing the workout. So that's the dream. But this was the the MVP version and easier to get out.
Yeah. Do you have I'm not familiar with technology, but do you have a patent on the SDK you use to determine the difference between the phone and the body?
So his question was just what type of patents or technology are specific in this? So really you could cheat the app. I can put my hand over the camera and I can say I did 300 push-ups, but you would know somebody's lying. You're only cheating yourself if you do that. So there's no technology in here that says that's a chest or that's a foot. What I hope to do is with the heart rate tracking is, so that's how I'm going to say, okay, they were working hard, they were actually pushing themselves and probably doing that workout is the idea behind the heart rate tracking. His question was just because of the way I want to do heart rate tracking, should I add a heart rate tracking monitor or some type of watch or something instead? And the way I see it in my head is you would do your heart rate tracking before you can start the exercise and then completely after you finish the entire 5-minute, 10-minute session. So not so much during and stopping the exercise, you would complete a couple minutes before. So that's the idea, but love to talk more and hear your ideas around how that might work. So
awesome. Thank you, Justin. I have an ATV shirt. Ooh. He was very excited about it. real excited. Is this a shirt that you want? He just yelled at me real loud. All right, I'm going to give it to him unless anybody really feels strongly about this shirt. No, you already got one. You can't get two. All right. To the gentleman who's very excited about the Atlantic Bowl shirt, we have more. It's too bad because Skip is back there like he has dance-off music ready to go. He really wants this to happen. We will make it happen for the next time, I promise. All right, are we switching over? We're switching over? Okay. Well, while she's still switching over, we good? We ready? Ready? Okay. All right, for this one, we have two presenters. So we are on our fourth presentation of the night. People in the back, I can hear you. Thank you. See, somebody gave me a microphone so I get all the power, and that's how that works. Okay, you guys ready to go? Okay, one more round of applause for Razor Juice.
Hi. Okay, so I just want to start off by asking you guys a quick question, just with like a show of hands. How many of you have been in a situation where your phone died and you couldn't charge it? Yeah, probably everyone, right? Everyone. So this is the problem that we're solving with our product. We have our solar-powered portable charger. It's powered by a 5-watt solar panel, and it has a USB connector. It's super flexible. It's really, like, razor thin, and it's pretty, and it's super lightweight. So it's also waterproof. So you can throw it in your beach bag, take it to the beach, take it on the boat for a long day out on the water, or you can clip it onto the back of your backpack at a festival or going on a hike. And you don't have to worry about scrambling to find a charging station or packing those three extra pre-charged portable chargers and then switching it out when those die. You can just keep on doing whatever you're doing and enjoying whatever you're doing because the sun is charging your device. And it's so light that you don't even notice that it's there. So, sorry, I'm actually going to go back. Sorry. So this is the small-scale practical problem that we're solving with our product. Is, like you guys said, you've all experienced it. Your phone is dead and you can't charge it. Whatever it is that you're doing, if you have one of these, you can charge your phone simply by being outside and being in the sun when you wouldn't be able to otherwise. So that's the small-scale practical problem that we're solving, but we also have a larger mission to, and like a larger mission and an aim to solve, play our part in solving a larger problem. So we really have reached a political tipping point on climate change and energy independence. I mean, it's at the forefront of conversations all around the world. And the Oxford Dictionary just named climate emergency the 2019 word of the year. So it's very prevalent right now. No matter personal opinions or political viewpoints, almost everyone is aware of the prevalence of this topic. So because of this, the shift to renewable energy is inevitable. Things like the solar car or mass solar facilities are going to become a norm in our societies. So we're kind of trying to be on the forefront of that because this is going to happen, but it's a big change. So we like to say that energy self-reliance starts with me. Any big change, not even just this one, starts with the individuals making those changes with themselves first. So that's our bigger mission here, aside from the practical, you're getting your phone charged. We really want to empower people to be energy self-reliant in this time where we're at such a such a tipping point on climate change. We want people to have solar on a small scale and build a trust in it and be more inclined to be with these bigger movements.
All right, so we have to make money if we go do this. Our big thrust is gonna be festivals. So think about going to a concert where you're outdoors and you can't plug into a charger. So we're going to start there. We're going to do boating, hiking, camping. A lot of us are ex-military, so we're going to go. We actually had this at the Pentagon, and Special Forces are looking at this when they're kind of shacked up in wherever they are. I can't really tell you where they are right now. But our goal is to just enable people to kind of have their phone living off the sun. And so, yeah, so oh my gosh. Anyway, so we're going to focus on festivals, military, hiking, camping, boating. And we have a price point that is very attractive.
Yeah,
let's do it. Let's do it.
He said, how can he help us market that?
I can offer equity, or I can offer a deal where you provide us dollars to go pay for quantities, and then I just give you half of what our post sales profits are.
Do you mean for like investment, or like how can you just as a consumer, as a buyer, help us get it out there?
I am very interested in customers. Okay. Sounds good. So I'm going from China right now, and I can get about 10,000 per month in, but we're going to ship production to the U.S. We're going to sell a few tonight. I'm sorry. So the question was, how many are we moving? And we have just started to figure out production, so we're just starting to make sales.
So I've had one of these solar chargers for a long time because I'm an avid camper. What makes you guys so different compared to the current stuff that's on the market? And how is your distribution strategy going to accentuate your advantage?
We're going to get it to people. Sorry. Question was, how do we differentiate ourselves in terms of distribution? We're gonna put it where people need it. So you can buy it on Amazon. I mean, it's available. But I'm gonna get it where you need it when you need it. Because when your phone dies, life is rough.
And I also sort of have a response for that as well. Another thing you said, you're an avid camper. One of our target demographics was festival goers, so people my age, the younger generations. And every single, not, oh my God, did that sound rude? I'm sorry. I'm so sorry, guys. No, but I just mean that most people that I've spoken to who are my peers, they're like, what? This exists? I don't know what this is. So another thing that we're going to do differently is a lot of these products exist, but they're just throwing them in Walmart and like hoping for the best usually. They're not using social media or any of these other avenues and putting it right where people are going to need it.
Well, it's interesting because I actually found mine through a social media post on REI like 4 years
Don't steal that. I'll figure that out.
How immediate is the gratification from it? Like, so when I, on best case scenario, sunny day, I plug my phone into it. Is it a reliable fast charge? I plug into the outlet, or is it kind of slow and a little bit more?
It's worse than going through an outlet. I'll put it that way.
Okay.
We're doing studies on it, and a couple of us are ex-nuclear engineers. So we're...
Not me.
She's not.
Thank you very much, guys. Okay. Don't worry, I have two options this time, people who yell real loudly up front. I have a shirt, I have socks. Oh, somebody got real... Is it the shirt? Is it the socks? So I'm working on getting a spinny wheel. Who would like a spinny wheel you get to spin like Wheel of Fortune? Yes? Okay. All right. Come back to me in January. We'll see what we got. Last Monday of the month of January. I know December's weird. I'm sorry. Okay. Are we down to our very last one?
Yeah.
We are. Last, but definitely not least, can we please give our final round of applause for the night for Mini City?
Hey, good evening, y'all. I'm India Hayes, and I'm the CEO and co-founder of Mini City Atlanta. So I'm not sure if you've heard of Mini City, but we are a tech resource hub that streamlines the admin process for getting legal forms of identification for the homeless and homeless care providers. Now, before I talk about our solution, I'm actually gonna go through how hard it is to get ID. So I want you guys to meet Andre. He's someone who is experiencing homelessness. Now, he has a job opportunity and a housing opportunity lined up, but he does not have ID. Now, to get state ID, he needs a birth certificate, but to get a birth certificate, he needs state ID. He could work with a local lawyer, but that is very expensive. He cannot afford it. He could also work with a third-party vendor, but that's expensive, and it also requires banking information and other stuff like credit history that he does not have. He could work with a local nonprofit, but he's already at his lifetime maximum for working with them to get ID. So he's at a really high risk for remaining homeless and not getting the benefits or access to stuff that he needs. So there's over 9,000 individuals on any given night in Georgia that are just like Andre. Now this is very detrimental to the individual, but also to our city. Atlanta spends over $68 million a year on just some of the costs related to homelessness. This is ER visits, jail stays, and more. And again, this is just some of the costs. So the addressable market is pretty huge for homelessness prevention. It's about $2 billion that are set aside in the United States and $41 million that's set aside in Georgia. At this time, we've interacted with 1 in 6 homeless citizens in Atlanta. That's right, we've assisted hundreds of homeless citizens in our city. And this is technology that is made just for them. We use something that's similar to a Fitbit or a Nike Fuel. They tap it to a tablet, and it opens up a dashboard where they can apply for ID, check on the status of ID, generate resumes, and more. This is smart tech for the homeless. And here's some live demos of our software working. On the front end, it's very simple, but on the back end, a lot of stuff is happening. It's filling out forms, it's generating resumes. Those are resumes of personal information, of course, hidden, of actual homeless citizens. So I wanted to actually, I could go on and on with like numbers, but I wanted to share a more personal story. This is a real LGBTQ couple that reached out to us that needed help. Again, we think of all these numbers, but again, these are real Mini City citizens and they agreed to share their story. They're experiencing homelessness and they were living out of their car, but we were able to get them ID in a few days. They were able to accept multiple job offers and make steps towards housing. So that's amazing. This is why we do what we do. And our information and our database is very secure. Our stuff is user verified, and by stuff I mean our software. As it travels, it's encrypted. Once it gets to the database, it's encrypted. We also use HIPAA Assure to make sure we're HIPAA compliant and more. And so with that ID, there's so much stuff that you guys cannot access. A US study found that the homeless without ID were not able to get housing, food stamps, Medicaid, and so much more. So we're beneficial for the homeless individual as well as homeless care providers, homeless shelters, and so on. At this time, we have customers, partners, and supporters. Some of them are the largest shelters in the world, and we've been featured on Vice, NPR, but I'm not here today to talk about our really cool press coverage. I'm here to talk about what makes us different. So we're efficient, we're tailored to the community that we work with, and we're scaling up to that smart city model. In our last pilot, we were able to get ID in as quick as 2 days. This is huge for the partners that we work with because they were looking at an average of 90 days, and the homeless just cannot wait that long to get benefits. So again, many cities meeting citizens where they are, while our competitors are really relying on stuff that the homeless do not have. Our business model is very simple. We have a basic package, we have a full service package where you can add on mailing, receiving, and delivering, and there's also add-ons for marketing and whatnot. And at this time, we offer a vital records event where we can process up to 1,000 homeless citizens at one time. So we're moving away from our original model, which again was that tablet kiosk, and moving up to the smart city model. So we can see our software in freestanding kiosks throughout the city of Atlanta and really across the nation. We've already built out the back end of the software. I won't go through all the features, but it's much more robust and really exciting. Our ask for 2020 is $300,000. So far, we have raised We've raised 10K from Startup Runway, and we were included in the SIN 2020 cohort. So why do we do the work? I do the work because I'm a technologist of color. This is primarily affecting my community. And many of our founders are also technologists of color. We do this because we care. Our CFO, he's from India, but he really cares about this issue, and he has a background in mechanical engineering. I'll wrap it up really quick. Our team has 13 years of experience. So I'm hoping with your help, we can bring this so-called hidden epidemic to light with tech, compassion, and care. Thank you. Thank you. Yes.
I want to know if it works in California.
So the question was, I want to know if it works in California, and we want to know if it works there too. We actually were asked by the city of Sacramento to come out and talk about our solution with their city. They're really excited, but the biggest thing, we're launching in Atlanta. They're like, hey, we want to see some really big numbers there so we can bring it to the West Coast. So hopefully I'll have more exciting news about that soon. Yes?
How familiar with the Dallas program are you? There's a city of Dallas is doing a program where the homeless people are getting jobs through the city, and eventually housing and Medicare was very profound, and ideas are really good start, but are you familiar with that program as well?
So the question was, are we familiar with a program in Dallas that helps the homeless get, it sounds like a housing first opportunity. Jobs and housing, and of course ID is included in that. So when we talk to investors, so many people think of Mini City as a like a business to business, and we are working with shelters and other groups. But the huge, huge thing that we want to scale up to is the B2G, business with government. So we haven't heard of Dallas, but we have seen with other states really successful models where a United Way and a bank and the city will invest $13 million for these really robust, they're called pay for success models, where you're paying for that success up front. We really want our city, so if y'all are looking at this, we want them to really get on board because we love models like that, where people who have that type of support can pay for it, and then you're able to come in as a sustainable solution. I love that. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So she asked about our wristbands and how are the homeless getting access to that to connect to the tablets. So we partner with homeless shelters. So we partner with Covenant House, Hope Atlanta. We've worked with Salvation Army, and we provide the wristbands on site. As you can imagine, especially when we're working in teen shelters, everybody lost the wristbands. So with our next, launch or whatnot, we're actually going to do away with it so you don't have to have wristbands or whatnot to access our services. But again, we really want to build up to that freestanding model where we're not only available in homeless shelters we're partnering with. Because as you know, as most of you guys know, there's homeless individuals everywhere. We really want freestanding kiosks so we don't have to rely on that. Yes?
Have you thought about integrating AI and facial recognition systems? How identification standards have to be limited and should really that person is there?
Yeah, absolutely. So he asked if I've thought of integrating AI and facial recognition and other cool stuff. We're really on the fence, trying to really listen to our users, and also our team tries to think, hey, if I'm creeped out by this, will other people be as well? So a huge thing is, one, that would be so good, amazing. Our former CTO thought of voice recognition, to unlock stuff, because that's kind of less intrusive, but still very friendly. And we're working on that. I think that would be really cool. It's just like, you want to tread the line of making this already a group that's very fearful of tech, and it's like, how much can we do without making them not really like us anymore? So, well, before I repeat it, do you mean like partnering with universities definitely. So the question was, have we thought of partnering with universities? Okay, cool. I'll answer really quick. Yes, absolutely. I want to make sure I understand the question, but in one way we thought of partnering with universities because there are homeless students that need to access ID or to stay enrolled. And another way, talking about risk averse or making sure students are protected, it would be really beneficial to have it at schools. It's just a different, customer segment where we have to really look at what do they need and how can we implement it.
Thank you very much. Great. We are the largest monthly meetup of entrepreneurs in the Southeast. Please join us at the end of January. And can I have one more round of applause for our awesome presenters tonight? Thank you all for coming.